Is anybody out there? Are we alone in the universe? Or is somewhere in the galaxy another planet that has spawned a civilization similar to ours? Or perhaps even on a much higher technical and intellectual level? Questions that all of us may have asked at one time or another. Hardly anything fascinates people more than the idea that somewhere out in space, other, possibly intelligent, and sentient living beings exist, and that one day, we will contact them. Others claim that this has long since happened. Countless books, novels, and movies about aliens and extraterrestrials have been made since the days of H.G. Wells. Many sci-fi movies and TV shows of the last decades were about contact or invasion by a superior and hostile alien race, or such aliens appeared in them. People's primal fear of the alien, the unknown, and the unimaginable is clearly evident in this imagination. Sometimes the cinematic visitors from outer space are peacefully minded, and their visit to Earth promises to be of great benefit to mankind. This might reflect a deep longing for brothers and sisters in space, as the idea of being alone in the vastness of the universe seems at least as frightening as hostile aliens to many people. And the thought that superior beings could reveal themselves to us possibly also includes some religious analogies. Certainly, there are many speculations when considering extraterrestrial life. This cannot be avoided with the topic. Let us leave aside for the moment the assertion of some people that extraterrestrials already are visiting or have already visited our planet. However, at the end of this video series we will also deal with this, especially the phenomenon of UFOs. Instead, at the start, we will pretend that UFOs do not exist and focus exclusively on the scientific search for life in space. But what is meant by scientific search? Scientists are looking for traces of life in our solar system with the tools of space exploration. Others are doing basic research at the chemical and biochemical level to learn when and under which conditions life might emerge on other planets. This science is called astrobiology. And of course, they also search for these very habitable worlds and other planetary systems using the tools of astronomy and astrophysics. Finally, a small group of enthusiasts is also conducting a search for signals or communication attempts from extraterrestrial civilizations. Such projects are grouped under the acronym SETI, short for Search for Extraterrestrial Intelligence. In this first video, we will deal with the basics, including the questions of what life actually is, how, why, and from what it originated on Earth, and whether it can also arise elsewhere in space. For this, we will look a little bit into physics, chemistry, and biochemistry. Nevertheless, it is quite interesting to have a look at the historical beginnings, how the fascination and also the fear of extraterrestrial life came about. In the 17th and 18th century, scholars like Christian Huygens and Immanuel Kant already made considerations about inhabitants of celestial bodies, but their assumptions were not really taken seriously by most other contemporary scientists. Later, in the second half of the 19th century, speculation grew when Charles Darwin's theory of evolution became more widespread, stating that life on Earth had evolved over periods of billions of years through natural processes from the simplest forms of life to greater diversity, complexity, and finally, to intelligent life. This concept made it seem possible that life had also evolved in a comparable way on other planets, especially after astronomy had shown that our Sun is just one star among billions of other similar stars. The peak of hysteria was reached with the discovery of the famous Martian canals at the end of the 19th century. Every 2 years, when Mars and Earth get closest to each other, our neighbor planet is best seen from Earth-bound telescopes. This was also the case in 1877, when Italian astronomer Giovanni Schiaparelli observed strange lines and other patterns on the surface of Mars. He referred to these lines as canali. Other astronomers also set out to find them, and they reported structures that ran in an almost straight line across the red planet's surface. Percival Lowell, who started as an amateur researcher and became one of the most famous astronomers of his time, finally even advanced to the thesis, the canals were engineered by extraterrestrials and had been created to save the Martian civilization from a major drought. According to Lowell's theory, the canals were artificial channels used by an advanced Martian race to lead water of the frozen polar region into the desert equatorial zones of Mars. Lowell was thoroughly convinced of this idea his entire life. He published several books and newspaper articles, and he even founded his own observatory in Flagstaff, Arizona, to provide evidence that our neighboring planet is inhabited, or at least once was. In 1897, Lowell's theories prompted British author H.G. Wells to write down his novel, which was to become the model for many future sci-fi books and stories, The War of the Worlds. In this novel, which was also the premise for several movie adaptations, Martians attacked Earth in huge tripod war machines to conquer our planet, because, unlike their own dying world, Earth was rich in resources and water. The United military was desperately inferior to the alien invaders, and people had to witness helplessly the cities being destroyed. Ultimately, only the bacteria of our planet were able to defeat the Martians due to their unadapted immune system. A radio play version of this novel, by Orson Welles and his New York Mercury Theater, staged as a fictional broadcast by the CBS radio station on the evening before Halloween in 1938, became particularly famous, or better infamous, since it was staged as if it was a real report of events that actually took place. According to newspaper reports, this broadcast led to severe irritation among the population of New York and New Jersey, who partly believed that what they were hearing was an authentic report and that an actual attack by alien invaders was happening. Obviously, many people tuned in later and did not hear the introductory monologue, which assured the audience that the following transmission was fictional. Next, we'll hear a short cut from the original broadcast.
Of the creatures in the rocket cylinder at Grover's Mill, I can give you no authoritative information either as to their nature, their origin, or their purposes here on Earth. Of their destructive instrument, I might venture some conjectural explanation. For want of a better term, I shall refer to the mysterious weapon as a heat ray. It's all too evident these creatures have scientific knowledge far in advance of our own. It's my guess that in some way they are able to generate an intense heat in a chamber of practically absolute non-conductivity. This intense heat they project in a parallel beam against any object they choose by means of a polished parabolic mirror of unknown composition, much as the mirror of a lighthouse projects a beam of light.
Allegedly, already during this broadcast, a mass panic occurred. People were reported to have been escaping from their homes and towns. Anyhow, subsequently, a number of newspapers reported on such occurrences. However, today it is believed that the excitement was not nearly as great as the newspapers reported, as the program had relatively few listeners, and that the mass panic was an invention of the yellow press, which may have been motivated by the intention to brand the new rival medium of radio as unreliable. Despite this episode, Lowell's theory could last for a long time and founded the myth of the Martians. However, in the years following the discovery of the canals, the speculations about life on Mars took on very bizarre forms. One theory published in the Salt Lake Tribune in 1912 was particularly absurd. It claimed that life on Mars consisted entirely of vegetation, but was controlled by a giant eye, a bizarre enormous life form, reaching about 100 miles into space. According to the newspaper, a giant Martian intellect was busy with the problems of sustaining life on the dying planet, and then exploring the boundless universe within its field of vision. Everyone may decide for themselves whether this report was really meant seriously or was just satire. With the beginning of astrophotography and ultimately the exploration of Mars by numerous unmanned probes, the mysterious Martian canals disappeared as quickly as they had appeared. Today, it is believed that the canals were optical illusions, faked by characteristics of the telescopes used at the time and by physiological effects related to the brightness and contrast of the Martian surface. Nevertheless, the belief in Martians persisted beyond the canals. Space exploration even created new myths, such as the famous face on Mars, photographed in 1976 by the Viking 1 Mars orbiter in the Cydonia Mensae region. The images showed an elevation 3 kilometers long and 1.5 kilometers wide, reminiscent of a human face. In addition, some pyramid-shaped rocks rise to the south of it. A few days later, the images were released to the public and caused huge headlines in daily press, in which these structures were portrayed as possible buildings of a long-gone Martian civilization. Higher resolution images, taken by the Mars Global Surveyor probe in 2001, showed that the supposed face was nothing but a highly weathered rock formation that had been eroded by natural processes. The resemblance to a human face was another illusion, caused by the interaction of light and shadow at the time the Viking orbiter image was made. Let's get back to the question posed at the beginning. Are we alone in space? Is there other life outside of our own planet? For many decades, even centuries, scholars and scientists have been asking these questions, making assumptions, speculating, discussing, and coming to very different conclusions. But the search for extraterrestrial life does not only imply intelligent or highly evolved life, but also and above all, more basic forms of life, for example animals, or just microorganisms, bacteria, fungi, viruses, or even plants. Common sense tells us that there may be only a few intelligent life forms, and even fewer highly advanced species that have developed something like culture, language, and technology. But life itself, in a more basic form, for example microorganisms such as bacteria, may well have arisen many times and at many different places in space. But these considerations raise many questions that have not yet been answered in a satisfying way. Did life come into being by chance? Is it an exception or the rule? Is life maybe an inevitable process, which has to emerge wherever the conditions are suitable for it? And if so, what kind of conditions are these? Would we recognize extraterrestrial life if we had it in front of us, and to what extent would it differ from terrestrial life forms? Many questions, and the most important one has not even been asked yet, namely the question of what life actually is. Every religion and every philosophy come up with its own and quite different myths or explanations. Science explains life in a much more complicated way. Simplified, one could say that life is very complex physics and chemistry. Depending on the perspective and scientific discipline, whether biology, chemistry, or physics, there are different attempts to approach a comprehensive definition of life. However, researchers have not yet agreed on an all-encompassing definition. Biology defines life as the ability of systems to organize and regulate themselves, as organic matter that interacts with the environment through energy and metabolism, replicates, grows, and is able to adapt to the environment through variation. As said before, there is still no clear generally accepted definition of life. After all, biologists have drawn up a list of criteria for determining living things. Accordingly, all life, as we know it, consists of at least one single cell, or arises from a cell, in which all biochemical processes take place. This qualifying remark just made, namely, as we know it, is an important point in this regard, and you will hear it again and again throughout these videos. In fact, we know only one kind of life, and that is the kind of life which exists on this planet, and which most likely goes back to a common origin. But there could be life that is so entirely different that we might not even recognize it as life, because it is based on physics and chemistry which we do not yet understand. On the other hand, everywhere in the universe the same chemical elements exist, which are subject to the same laws of nature as here on Earth. Consequently, all life on Earth, whether we are talking about bacteria, algae, plants, animals, or humans, is made up of the same chemical building blocks and it goes through the same or at least very similar biochemical and biological processes. If we consider life, as we know it, in its most basic form, as unicellular microorganisms, which were probably the first life forms to have existed on our planet, there is not really much that it has to be capable of. In its most primitive form, life must actually be able to do only one thing, and that is replication. In biochemistry, replication is always the result of metabolic processes. So, life must constantly metabolize in order to replicate. In fact, almost every hypothesis about life is about metabolism and replication. There are also other phenomena and processes in nature that show some forms of metabolism, growth, and replication, although we wouldn't necessarily count them as life. For example, crystals can grow and replicate, but they are definitely not alive. Or let's take the example of fire. Metabolism means the ability of absorbing substances, transporting them, transforming them chemically and releasing them again into the environment. Fire fulfills all these properties because it absorbs combustible substances and oxygen, transforms them in chemical processes, and transports heat and light. Nevertheless, despite its chemical metabolism, fire is not a life form. Also, according to the definition just mentioned, viruses should not be living beings, since they do not possess either independent replication, nor their own metabolism, and are therefore dependent on the metabolism of a host cell. For this reason, virologists are largely in agreement that viruses should not be counted as living organisms. However, they can at least be considered close to life because they generally possess the ability to control their replication and the ability to evolve. Another characteristic of life on Earth is the ability to store and transfer information. This information system, within the cells, is sort of a program or blueprint that stores information in complex molecules. This enables life to make copies of itself, so to speak. However, the copying system is not entirely static, because it allows for variations. With each copying process, new variations are created, and those variations which are better adapted to the environmental conditions replicate better, and this is exactly what we call evolution. Evolution is actually nothing but optimization. Life is adaptable. If it wouldn't be so, mankind would have been eliminated by the simplest flu germs a long time ago. Actually, life is so highly adaptable that it can be found even in places we would consider completely uninhabitable, such as this hot lake, full of sulfur gases, the Grand Prismatic Spring in Yellowstone National Park. The colors come from unicellular microorganisms, bacteria, and archaea, in the peripheral areas of this hot spring. They are so-called thermophiles, organisms which tolerate high temperatures. The counterparts to these are the cryophiles, which are adapted to particularly cold environments. Others are adapted to high salt and methane concentrations, or high pressures, levels of pH, or toxic substances. There are even simple organisms that are able to endure very high doses of ionizing radiation. For example, some species of fungi that were found on the reactor walls at the destroyed Chernobyl nuclear power plant. Even in the deep sea, where very high pressure, no light and hardly any oxygen prevail, and boiling hot water escapes from hydrothermal vents, there is life. At least we do find microbes and unicellular organisms here that have adapted through evolution to the seemingly most impossible environmental conditions. However, and this is the special aspect, without exception, these are all basic forms of life, microorganisms, algae, or fungi. They seem to have a higher resistance to extreme environmental conditions or to adapt to them more quickly than higher evolved life is able to. Therefore, it makes sense to look for simpler life forms in space first, because it is much more likely that they exist even under supposedly hostile planetary conditions. In our solar system, complex life has evidently evolved only on Earth. Apparently, our planet is a special place in cosmos. But is it really that special that nothing like Earth will ever exist again? Or is it rather rare? Could it be that worlds, on which complex life is possible, are completely normal? We don't know that either. According to the so-called Copernican principle, there is nothing special about the Earth and life on Earth. And therefore, it is likely that complex life is widespread in the universe. At the same time, this model states that the human race does not hold an outstanding or special position, but only a typically average status in the universe. Of course, this contradicts the vast majority of religions and theories that want to see mankind as the crown of creation and the measure of all things. However, the sheer size of the universe or the number of stars and planets is already enough to make us suspect that this might be wishful thinking. Actually, the universe is so big, and it contains so many stars and planets that it could be probable that somewhere even beings exist which are absolutely identical to us humans. The Copernican principle is opposed by the rare Earth hypothesis, which claims the opposite. It states that for the emergence of life, and especially for highly developed life, so many conditions must be fulfilled that, compared to this, it would be more likely to hit the lottery jackpot 10 times in a row. The coincidence of all these conditions would be so improbable that as a result, complex life is extremely rare. We will see later which conditions are meant. Life is complex physics and chemistry, which means it consists of molecules and atoms. The chemical elements must have been already present long before the origin of life on Earth. In fact, the same elements occur everywhere in the universe. The two fundamental elements, hydrogen and helium, were probably formed with the creation of the universe. All other, heavier elements evolved through nuclear fusion processes within the stars, the nucleosynthesis, or they were created by supernovae and hypernovae. Inside the stars, among other things, carbon, the element we are mostly made of, was formed, but also neon, oxygen, and iron. All heavier elements beyond iron, in other words, those with higher atomic numbers in the periodic table, were probably formed by stellar explosions. Through these supernovae, the lighter elements, accumulated inside the stars, are spread within the interstellar medium as well. This also includes carbon and oxygen. So, we would not exist if they were not dispersed in space by stellar explosions, because new stars, planets, and occasionally life emerges from this matter. Viewed in this way, we and all living organisms are, so to speak, stardust. But that all of this is going on is also due to the fact that the laws of nature and the forces in the universe are exactly as they are and not otherwise. The fundamental forces of physics influence and control the processes inside the stars. If the universe and thus the fundamental basic forces were a little bit different, there might not be enough heavier elements in the universe to make life possible. Life with all its requirements needs complex chemical structures. They have to be reactive, able to form complex chemical bonds, like long chains or cyclic structures, but at the same time these bonds must be stable. If we look at the periodic table, which chemical elements can meet all those requirements? Well, quite a few of them can be ruled out just from the start. For example, the noble gases, such as neon, argon, krypton, and xenon. They are very inert and hardly form chemical bonds with other elements. The same applies to the halogens or salt formers such as chlorine, bromine, iodine, and fluorine with their negatively charged ions. They are reactive, of course, but their chemical bonds are not stable. This is also the case with the alkali and alkaline earth metals with their positively charged ions. The metals of the lanthanide and actinide groups, as well as all other metals, can also be excluded because they form chemical bonds that are too large and too stable. All that remains is hydrogen in the upper left corner of the periodic table, as it is a component of water, and water is a main ingredient of all life, plus a small group of elements, in particular, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, phosphorus, sulfur, and selenium, but also boron and silicon. They all share one special characteristic. All of them are able to form so-called covalent bonds, which allow complex molecular structures, for example double bonds and cyclic structures. And their bonds are reactive and stable at the same time. In covalent bonds, the outer electrons play a major role. Through the interaction between them, atoms form at least one pair of electrons. No wonder that all the basic elements of life are found in this part of the periodic table. Carbon in particular stands out among them. It is the scaffolding element of life. With the exception of our bones and teeth, which are mainly composed of calcium, and the fact that the human body is more than 70% water, we are made entirely of carbon. This is no coincidence because carbon is particularly versatile. In fact, we only know life that is based on this element. This is why we sometimes speak of carbon chauvinism. As alternatives, life forms based on silicon, boron, nitrogen, or sulfur are often proposed, which can also form stable macromolecules under certain conditions. In particular, silicon-based life is discussed seriously again and again, and is also readily taken up in science fiction. Silicon is not only placed exactly below carbon in the periodic table, but it also has similar chemical properties. The silicon atom can form four bonds, just like carbon. A good prerequisite for complex chemistry. But would silicon-based life be possible? The prerequisites for life arise only when chemical reactions take place, especially when molecular bonds are formed and dissolved again. The molecules involved must be reactive enough to initiate chemical reactions. But they must also be chemically stable in the process. If we compare the silicon atom with the carbon atom, we see that the silicon atom is larger. Or scientifically correct, it has a larger atomic radius. That means the electron shell or electron cloud is bigger. We'll see in a moment the problems caused by this difference in size when it comes to multiple bonds. The electron cloud, and the number of electrons, is the most interesting part of an atom, because this is where the chemical reactions ultimately take place, as bonds always take place by shared electrons. If the first bonding partner pulls harder on the electrons, it becomes richer in electrons and thus acquires a higher negative charge. The second bonding partner, on the other hand, receives a higher positive charge. This attribute, the tendency of an atom to attract shared electrons, is called electronegativity. A classic example for this is water. Water molecules consist of one oxygen atom and two hydrogen atoms. The oxygen atom has a significantly higher electronegativity than the hydrogen atoms, therefore it pulls harder on the shared electrons, which causes a dipole. That is, a negative partial charge of the oxygen atom, and at the same time a charge shift to the hydrogen atoms as a positive partial charge. This is the simplest hydrocarbon, methane. It consists of one carbon atom and four hydrogen atoms. The carbon atom also has a slightly higher electronegativity than the hydrogen atoms, but this is sufficient to give methane chemical stability. The situation is different for the silicon counterpart to methane, the monosilane, because here the balance of power is reversed. Due to the lower electronegativity of the silicon atom compared to the hydrogen atoms, monosilane is extremely unstable and even highly flammable and self-ignites in contact with oxygen. This fact shows that it is not possible to simply replace a carbon-hydrogen bond with a silicon-hydrogen bond, which means that silicon gets rid of a very important bonding partner, namely hydrogen, in order to make silicon molecules with the same properties as carbon molecules. Silicon is also difficult when it comes to double or multiple bonds. This is due to the large size of the silicon atom. Here's an example. The hydrocarbon ethylene consists of two carbon atoms, which are connected by a double bond. This means that the two atoms are connected by two electron pairs, that is, by four electrons. However, an analogous molecule with silicon atoms does not exist at all. Why? Because silicon atoms are too large and the electrons thus too far apart for a double bond due to the large electron clouds. They only allow single bonds. Chemical bonds are formed by overlapping of electron clouds. More precisely, through overlaps of so-called orbitals. Without getting too much into quantum mechanics, orbitals can be imagined as the space that electrons fill around the nucleus of the atom. But orbitals have different shapes and sizes. A single chemical bond is formed by overlapping of so-called s orbitals, which are spherical in shape. As already mentioned, chemical bonds are shared electrons, and if an atom has a stronger pull on electrons, it gains a higher negative charge as a result. The other bonding partner instead receives a higher positive charge. Starting with the element boron, the so-called p orbitals come into play, which are club or hourglass shaped. Per energy level, an atom has three p orbitals, which differ in their orientation. In case of silicon atoms, however, the orbitals are so large that the s orbitals still overlap. But the p orbitals are too far apart, so double bonds do not form. So, although silicon has four bonding partners, most double bonds are unstable, with the exception of silicon-oxygen bonds. In fact, silicon is only capable of forming very large structures, called solids. And only these bonds are stable. Carbon dioxide is known to be a gas. The counterpart in silicon dioxide, on the other hand, is a solid. It's quartz, as we found in rocks and sand. Silicon obviously does not find the right balance between reactivity and stability. At least under the conditions known to us, only carbon provides this range between relatively small molecules such as carbon dioxide or methane, to huge complex structures such as proteins or DNA. Nevertheless, it cannot be completely ruled out that under certain environmental conditions, some kind of preliminary stages of silicon-based life could develop. It is doubtful, however, whether these could eventually evolve into actual life forms. We have known for a long time that the building blocks of life do not only exist on Earth. Astronomers have already discovered around 200 different complex molecules in space. Among them are really complex ones like propylene oxide and glycol nitrile, or the basic amino acids. However, those complex molecules cannot exist freely in space, but only where they are shielded from harmful electromagnetic radiation, especially ultraviolet, X-ray, and gamma radiation. This high energetic radiation breaks and splits complex molecules into simpler molecules, atoms, or ions. This process is called dissociation. On our Earth, the atmosphere with its ozone layer shields life from such dangerous radiation. Thus, the evidence of complex molecules has so far only been detected beneath planetary atmospheres and inside of dense gas nebulae, so-called molecular clouds. However, this is interesting insofar as stars and planetary systems are formed from such nebulae. The question is, how likely is it that something like life will emerge from a soup of random molecules through chemical reactions? Is it just a matter of time, or is it an incredible coincidence? The Earth was formed about 4.5 billion years ago. After that, it cooled down so that water could exist on the planet in liquid form. Here, the first chemical reactions of organic compounds were already formed. These were carbon compounds, and with them certainly already the first building blocks of life existed, such as amino acids as building blocks for proteins or nucleotides as building blocks for DNA. However, the fact that life could develop from these building blocks was made possible by various circumstances that led to environmental conditions favorable for this. Also, with cosmic events. For example, we know that the protective effect of the Earth's atmosphere and the magnetic field favored the emergence and development of life. But how did it come about? A special feature of the Earth is the fact that it has a relatively large moon. The moon influences our planet in different ways, especially its gravity has a stabilizing effect on the rotation axis of the Earth. It also caused tides, which may have played a role in the development of life. Yet, according to the most current theory, the formation of the moon was due to a cataclysmic event that nearly led to the destruction of the early Earth. Shortly after the formation of the solar system, about 4.5 billion years ago, a protoplanet, about half the size of the Earth and later called Theia, collided with the still incandescent proto-Earth, which at that time already had about 90% of its present mass. The collision was not head-on, but grazing, so that large amounts of material, consisting of parts of the mantle of Theia and the Earth's mantle, were hurled into Earth's orbit as the iron cores merged. The heavy metallic elements were concentrated in an early core, and the somewhat lighter rock components in a massive glowing mantle. The remnant of Theia mixed with our Earth was ejected out into space. Earth soon resumed its spherical shape for isostatic reasons, which inevitably happens to all planetary bodies larger than about 350 kilometers. Later, the traces of the impact on Earth disappeared. However, plenty of dust and debris continued to fly around our planet. Some of it cooled, condensed, and gradually contracted under gravity over time into a sphere, namely our moon. Earth's iron core presumably became larger and heavier as a result of this event. Since then, it consists of a solid inner and presumably liquid outer core. The core heats the overlying liquid material, which rises and finally meets cooler layers. Here, it passes on its heat and cools down slightly in the process. As a result, the material sinks back down again. This cycle is called convection flow. The Earth's magnetic field thus induces an electric current in the conductive and liquid material, which counteracts the decay of the magnetic field. Ultimately, this benefited life on Earth, especially with respect to the development of higher life forms. Because Earth's magnetic field provides a life-sustaining radiation shield. It extends tens of thousands of kilometers into space and protects our planet from the charged particles of the solar wind, the cosmic radiation that would otherwise have destroyed the upper atmosphere and also reached the surface. Without a magnetic field, life on our planet would probably not have evolved beyond its more primitive preliminary stages. At the beginning, Earth was completely uninhabitable. It was formed as a hot ball of glowing molten rock, surrounded by hot, corrosive, and poisonous gases. This sounds like a description of hell, and from the Greek word Hades, for hell, also comes the name of this time, Hadaic. It ended about 4 billion years ago. The Earth had cooled down, and the surface became solid. However, our planet's crust is not a rigid structure but consists of moving plates. This fact may have contributed to the evolution of life. Plate tectonics has an important function for the release of heat from the Earth's interior. It also has an influence on the Earth's climate. It acts like a thermostat and ensures that the average global temperature on Earth is kept largely constant over billions of years. However, a planet only exhibits plate tectonics when its chemical composition allows it. When the solar system was about 600 million years old, a large number of asteroids collided with the early planets in the inner solar system, including Mercury, Venus, Earth, and Mars. These events may have significantly delayed the emergence of life on Earth. During the earliest phase of evolution on Earth, which occurred between 4.6 and 3.5 billion years ago, the hot oceans contained relatively high concentrations of iron and nickel ions. A current theory of the origin of life assumes the development of primitive metabolism on iron-sulfur surfaces under conditions encountered through volcanic outgassing. Similar conditions are found today next to hydrothermal vents that have formed and are still forming in plate tectonic fault zones on the seafloor. Thermophilic and methanogenic bacteria thrive in the vicinity of such black smokers. This extreme biotope shows that life can exist independently of sunlight as an energy source, a fundamental requirement for the origin and maintenance of life before the beginning of photosynthesis. Besides the chemical building blocks, the presence of water was one of the most important factors. Life, as we know it, cannot develop or exist without water. It serves as a solvent for nutrients. Biochemical reactions, such as photosynthesis or cellular respiration, cannot take place without water. By the way, as a solvent, water has no serious rival. Ammonia, for example, only liquefies at low temperatures. It reacts with oxygen in order to form nitrogen monoxide and oxidizes to nitric acid. Scientists believe that the water originated from comets. These chunks of ice and dust originally formed at the edge of the solar system. However, some of them also got on orbits into the inner solar system and became part of the freshly formed planets. The ice of the comets evaporated on the hot protoplanet's surface. Since the water vapor was much lighter than the molten rock, it moved upward toward the surface. It escaped there through volcanoes into the atmosphere. Consequently, the early Earth's atmosphere consisted of 80% water vapor. In addition, there was about 10% carbon dioxide and some hydrogen sulfide. Then, as the Earth slowly cooled down, the vapor became liquid water again. It began to rain. These first downpours must have been stronger than any thunderstorm we can imagine today. And it must have rained for a very long time, several tens of thousands of years. Large parts of the young Earth's surface were flooded, in some places up to 10 kilometers high. This is how the oceans were formed. And the oceans were the jackpot for life on Earth. Like the atmosphere, the ocean is constantly in motion. Ocean water flows horizontally at the surface or in the deep, or it sinks and rises vertically. These oceanic currents are extremely important for maritime life and have an influence on our planet's climate. The Earth was formed 4.5 billion years ago. But life as we know it did not emerge until a whole billion years later. At least, that's the earliest evidence we have for the existence of single-celled organisms, the most primitive forms of life. We do not know what happened in the billion years in between. In the 1950s, the so-called central dogma of molecular biology was postulated, stating that life, in its most primitive sense, only needs three main components: DNA, RNA, and proteins. The first main component, DNA, desoxyribonucleic acid, is a long-chain molecule made up of different nucleotides. DNA carries the genetic information in all living things. The individual sections of DNA serve as matrices for the construction of the second main component of life, namely RNA, ribonucleic acid. This makes sure that genetic information is transcribed from DNA into RNA. The RNA strands built up on the DNA template, in this process, fulfill different tasks. They are ultimately involved in the biosynthesis of proteins, the third main component of life. DNA is the construction manual, but it actually cannot build anything all by itself. That's the job of the proteins, by converting the DNA information into biological function. But the proteins cannot do this without RNA, because this is the one that forms the proteins and decodes the code of the DNA. RNA must copy itself with every replication, with every cell division, and in turn, RNA needs the proteins that carry out this process. In other words, DNA, RNA, and proteins, none of these three parts can work without the other two. Without RNA and proteins, there would be no DNA. And proteins would not be created in the first place without DNA and RNA. So, what came first? And how could the other two come into being? That's a classic chicken and egg dilemma. In the 1980s, chemists discovered something about RNA that led to new theories. It was already known that RNA, like DNA, carries information because it is made up of nucleotides just like DNA. It was also found that RNA also catalyzes or drives chemical reactions just like proteins. This would mean that RNA is able for both, carrying information and catalyzing its own replication. Thus, RNA alone would have all the functions necessary for the emergence of life. If this is true, it would simplify the central dogma of life. According to this theory, before life as we know it today, there was only RNA, a world with more primitive conditions of life. According to this model, only much later DNA evolved for more complex information and proteins, for more complex biological reactions. A hint that there may have once been such an RNA life era has been found in specific molecular structures. This is the structure of vitamin B12, which is also called cobalamin, an important enzyme for cell division, blood formation, and nerve function. The active core of cobalamin is located around a central cobalt ion. But down here it is bound to a building block of RNA, and actually nobody knows what it's doing there. It has no active function inside the enzyme. Some researchers therefore believe this could be some kind of a biochemical relic, a molecular fossil, so to speak, a remnant of the long-gone RNA era. Life, as we have learned, works through information and metabolism. But the latter hardly plays a role in the RNA world model. So again, which came first? Genetic information or metabolic process? In the hypothetical RNA world, genetic information stands above everything else. However, there are also opinions to the contrary. The representatives of the so-called metabolism-first hypothesis say that reactions of molecules would have led to simple organic compounds, possibly with the help of the catalytic properties of minerals. These compounds could be combined in various ways to form simple amino acids, lipids, and nucleic bases, which could then act as catalysts for the formation of more sophisticated molecules. The beginning of a metabolism would have been made. However, the building blocks of life do not necessarily have to have come from outer space. Stanley Miller and Harold Urey proved as early as 1953 at the University of Chicago in their famous experiment, that under certain circumstances organic molecules could be formed from inorganic substances. In their experimental setup, they filled a 5-liter vessel with a mixture of methane, ammonia, hydrogen, and carbon monoxide. Connected to this was another vessel, half filled with water, representing the primordial ocean. The water was heated and evaporated. Finally, electrical discharges were twitched through the gas-water vapor mixture, simulating lightning. After only 1 week, many organic molecules had been formed in this primordial soup, including simple amino acids. The Miller-Urey experiment was often repeated under slightly different conditions. The experiment does not explain the origin of life, but at least the possible origin of the building blocks necessary for it. Under such conditions, simpler organisms, so-called prokarya, such as bacteria and archaea, were initially formed. They do not yet have a cell nucleus and their DNA is located freely in the cytoplasm. Although many would not suspect it, but unlike carbon, oxygen was not one of the elements necessary for the origin of life. It did not play an essential role in molecular evolution. In fact, oxygen was not needed for the earliest forms of life on Earth. They were anaerobic, which means that they did not need molecular oxygen for their metabolism. Especially since oxygen was hardly available in the early Earth's atmosphere. Molecular oxygen in our atmosphere is a product of biological activity. It was first formed by microorganisms in early Earth history, then later by vegetation, trees, and plants, which continue to do so today, ensuring the survival of all aerobic life on Earth, including us humans. However, the earliest life forms shoveled their own grave, so to speak. Probably about 2.4 billion years ago, microorganisms, according to current knowledge forerunners of today's cyanobacteria, developed a new form of photosynthesis that produced molecular oxygen as a byproduct. As a result, oxygen was formed in large quantities in the oceans. The increasing oxygen levels in the oceans probably wiped out a large percentage of the anaerobic organisms inhabiting the Earth at that time. The oxygen was lethal to them and largely responsible for what was probably the greatest mass extinction ever seen on Earth. Today, this mass extinction is called the Great Oxidation Event. Later, carbon dioxide was continuously removed from the Earth's atmosphere by various processes. For example, through the binding of carbon in biomass or biogenic minerals and through photosynthesis. With the so-called ozone-oxygen cycle, also called Chapman cycle, and under the influence of the ultraviolet radiation of the sun, an ozone layer was formed. Only then higher developed eukarya could arise, with a cell nucleus and a nuclear membrane, as the ozone layer absorbed the shortwave ultraviolet radiation from the sun, protecting organisms and later all evolved life forms, such as plants and animals, from radiation damage. However, the development of life on Earth was repeatedly slowed down by natural disasters, which forced evolution in other directions. More than 99% of all organisms that have ever existed on Earth have become extinct. While new species emerged, others disappeared forever. However, the process of extinction does not occur at a constant rate. In the last 500 million years, it has happened at least 5 times that between 75 and more than 90% of all living things on Earth disappeared virtually within a geological instant. These ecological catastrophes are called mass extinctions. Best known is an event 65 million years ago, when, along with the dinosaurs, about 80% of all species became extinct, the result of an asteroid impact. There were also climate catastrophes that caused life on Earth to suffer. Between 750 and 580 million years ago, the Earth actually froze over completely several times, from the poles to the equator. A phenomenon that geologists today refer to as snowball Earth. All this may have led to the fact that the human species came on the scene only late, a few million years ago. But perhaps, if only one of these events had not taken place, humans would never have come into existence. Since we cannot vividly imagine the great periods of billions and millions of years, it is a popular method to shorten the 4.6 billion years since the formation of Earth until today to the period of only 1 year. One day in this picture equals about 13 million years of reality. One month is about 380 million years. On January 1st, Earth was formed, and still at the beginning of January the impact of Theia occurred, which caused the formation of our moon. It is still January, when numerous comets and meteorites hit the newborn Earth, and a water vapor atmosphere was created. At some point in February, the oceans were formed, and by the end of March, the earliest unicellular organisms come into play. Life takes its beginning. Early July, the first photosynthesis occurs, with release of oxygen, leading to the extinction of all anaerobic organisms. And then little happens for a long time. Only in autumn the first vertebrates are formed. Life leaves the oceans and colonizes the continents. Biodiversity picks up speed rapidly. It is not until December 31st, around 11:30 p.m., that modern humans evolve. Up to here we have to owe already quite many circumstances that life on Earth has been able to evolve. And still, we are only with the life in general, not yet with intelligent life or culturally and technologically evolved civilizations. Thank you for your interest. In the next part we will leave the Earth and go into space to look for traces of life. We will start in our cosmic neighborhood, the other planets of our solar system. We would appreciate a like and a subscription. Goodbye, see you next time.